Welcome to the next lecture on parallel algorithms. This recording covers a short chapter on list ranking, which is kind of another somewhat less well-known because it's a bit theoretical basic tool for designing parallel algorithms. And it's a preparation for the somewhat longer chapter on parallel graph algorithms. Okay, so the basic motivation here is that there's a sharp contrast between arrays and linked lists with respect to parallel processing, or at least seemingly so. So in particular, on an array, we can do many things in parallel by just assigning segments of the array to different processors. Or we can compute prefix sums over an array in order to solve a large number of problems. We have already seen quite a number of examples. But what about linked lists? Mathematically, they are very similar, right? They represent a sequence of elements. But accessing these elements is inherently sequential, at least if we have only the information given by the links. And that is, of course, a problem, because on the other hand, linked lists are more flexible. And we will see now that under certain circumstances, we can do everything with linked lists, what we can do with arrays. In particular, we can convert them into arrays in parallel, or another view is we can compute prefix sums on them in parallel. So how can that work? So the additional assumption we need here is, okay, so the assumption we make is that the list items themselves are stored in an array. So you may now say, oh, you are cheating. I mean, then I could do the things in an array in the first place. But the point is all the computations we are doing will respect the order specified by the by the links, by the pointers. And that gives us flexibility in many parallel applications. And also, if you think about how actually a linked list is represented in a computer, then, well, I mean, the list items are stored somewhere in memory. And the assumption we really make here is that the list items we are interested in are concentrated in some compact part of the memory. And that's not automatically guaranteed, but in most applications, we can make sure that this is the case. And of course, I'm talking about shared memory things here. So more precisely, the notation we are using here looks a little bit Fortran-ish. That's because I am using the notation as it is in the book by Jaja. And also in my book, I have adopted much of this notation. So we denote L, our list, N is the number of elements. And the list is represented by an array S of successor indices and an array P of predecessor indices. And the end of the list is marked by an element whose successor is itself. And what I'm working with in the list ranking computation is an additional array R, which by default is initialized by all ones, except that at the last element we have a zero. Or we could have a more general variant of the problem where we say, okay, R is initialized with some value. And what we want to do actually is to compute a prefix sum over these values. But the ordering for the prefix sum is defined by the successor pointers. So when in the special case that the initial rank values are all one, this computation will compute the distance to the end. And for example, this is useful because if we have the distance to the end, we can convert the linked list into an array by storing the ith item in the array at position n minus r of I. So let's go back to our motivation. Now maybe I can explain it in a more technical way. So in a sense, lists are very simple graphs. They are a directed graph that is a path, right? So in that sense, I claim it's a warm-up for graph algorithms. And actually, it turns out that the techniques we are using here, and also list ranking itself, is very often used within graph algorithms. And maybe an important point here is what makes parallel graph algorithms difficult are long paths. So they are often the main obstacle for parallelization. And so in a sense, although we have special graphs here, we in some sense have very difficult special graphs. And it turns out in particular that what I describe here for paths can very often be generalized to also work for trees. Okay, so let's first look at a sequential algorithm for list ranking. We first identify the last element. That we can do in parallel. Maybe it's a simple exercise you can think about how to do that in parallel. And now, in that description, I'm chasing backwards using the R pointers. So I'm iterating over a variable R that gives us the current rank or the current distance from the end, which is initially zero, and at the end it's n minus one. And we simply assign the E, the rank of the ith reached element, to R. And then we set I to the predecessor of I. And yeah, I think this is really inherently sequential. But the good news is that it has work order n. But of course, it's also time theta n. And then the question is, can we make that faster? And can we do that in an efficient way? So I will now explain a very fast and simple algorithm. And later we will make it more efficient. So here's a so-called pointer doubling algorithm. It's for CREW PREM. And for the case that the number of elements is the same as the number of processors. This is relatively easy to generalize to larger n, but I will come to that. Okay. The idea is, well, first we have an invariant, basically that the R values, when you take any item and follow the pointers given by an auxiliary array Q, then the Q array will lead you to the end of the list. And the R values you encounter on that path will sum to the actual rank of item I. We initialize Q with S, and then we basically have the definition of the original problem, right? We want to compute the sum over the initial R values. And by default, the initial R values are 1, right? And now we have this auxiliary array Q, which will turn out to make larger jumps over the iteration of the algorithm. It will make larger and larger jumps. And eventually, we terminate when all the Q pointers directly point to the end, and then we have computed what we want. Okay, so how can we do this fast? So this is a single program, multiple data, pseudocode. I is the processor index. And now each processor individually executes this link. So do something while the rank of QI is non-equal zero. So we require here that the input values for R are larger than zero, except for the end. So we use this as an end flag. So, and what am I doing? So the only thing is that so this word doubling means I take the 2 Q pointers together, so I follow one Q pointer and then another one, and makes this a new Q pointer. So let's look at this example. So we are, say we are processor 4. In the first step, the successor of the item stored at position 4 points here, and the successor of that successor points here. So processor 4 says, okay, I follow this pointer and that pointer, and now I set this pointer to the combination of these two jumps, and I get a jump that is larger. And in order to maintain my invariant on the R values, I'm adding the two R values encountered that way. And this is done independently by all the processors. They are concurrently reading data, but they are only writing to their entries of the R and Q arrays. So it's exclusive write. So how long does that take? I mean, the basic idea is that the distances jumped will double in each iteration, except if I have already reached the end. So let's make that formal. Our induction hypothesis is that after k iterations, and this is now for the case that the rank values are initially 1, otherwise we have to formulate it a little bit more complicatedly, but we get the same result at the end. So after k iterations, either the rank is 2 to the k, or the rank at I is the final result. So this is trivially true for k equals 0, because then Ri is 1, or it is 0 at the final element, right? Now let's do the induction step from k to k minus 1. There are 3 cases to distinguish. So if the current rank of I is less than 2 to the k, then by the induction hypothesis, this can only be the case if Ri already has the final value. Then if R of I is equal to 2 to the k, but the R value of the element pointed to by the Q pointers is less than 2 to the k, then this Q of I thing already has the final value, and following this one pointer, plus the next one leads me to the final element, so now I have the final value. And we can have the case that both R of I and R of Q of I are 2 to the k, then the new value will be 2 to the k plus 2 to the k is 2 to the k plus 1, which is what I wanted to prove. Now, the point is the initial rank values are all 1, and we have this invariant saying that if we sum the values, we get the distance to the end. But the distance to the end can get no larger than n. So actually, k can go no larger than log n. So after log n iterations, our algorithm has terminated, meaning that we have running time theta log n. Unfortunately, the work is n log n. And it doesn't really help a lot to apply Brand's principle here, right? You can now assign n over p list items to each processor, and they could execute this algorithm here, right? And then it would take not log p, but log n iterations. Fine. But in each iteration, there will have to be done work for every list item. So the work actually remains n log n, regardless how many processors I'm using. So we always have a log n factor more work than the sequential algorithm, so the efficiency is not good. And of course, you see the pattern in my lecture. We will address this problem now. The more efficient algorithm is called independent set removal. It's a somewhat more complicated algorithm. I managed to fit the pseudocode on a single slide, but it's sufficiently ugly that I first want to explain it using pictures. So the basic algorithmic pattern is called a multi-level algorithm. So a multi-level algorithm, I'm making the problem smaller by removing some pieces of the problem. Then I recursively solve the smaller problem. And then I use the information gained in solving the smaller problem to solve the overall problem. And concretely for list ranking, what we are doing is we are removing a carefully selected set of elements, which is called an independent set for reasons that will become clear very soon. I build a new instance that helps me to that somehow represents the entire input well, solves this new instance, and then use the solution of the new instance to construct a solution of the full problem. So what does it mean, carefully selecting something I remove? The point is I remove a set of items that is independent in the sense that the removed elements, their successors and their predecessors, they remain in the set. Why this is useful, we will see very soon. So in this case, we remove two because the successor remains. So the green ones are removed, the black ones remain, and the predecessor also remains. We remove three because the predecessor remains, and the successor remains, and the predecessor remains. We remove five. And eight, right? Now, what does removing mean? Basically, for the remaining elements, we do one doubling step, or more precisely, the remaining elements, they look at the successor, say the four, they look at the successor, and if the successor is removed, they jump over it. Similar to what you do in a doubling step. For example, the four sees this and this, so it in the reduced problem, it immediately jumps to the seven. Actually, that you can see that here in this jump, here I have renumbered the elements because I use numbers for the contracted, for the smaller input, right? And in order to make this contraction useful, I'm adding the R values I encounter. In this case, this is the value 2. So in the reduced instance, the surviving element here will get a rank value of 2. Actually, that may not be an optimal example here because here I never have the situation that the successor is actually also remaining, because then I don't do anything. I just keep the successor as it is, and I keep the rank value as it is. So the result is that I have a new instance, S prime, P prime, R prime, that very well represents the input in the following sense. So now I'm renumbering the elements here. So now they are stored in a compacted array, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I solve this thing recursively, and I get the following rank values. My 4 gets a rank value of 8. Why is that? Okay, we have this. In this case, each of these jumps represents a rank value of 2, so 2, 4, 6, 8, right? Or the 4 here, 2, 4, 6, and so on. And the thing is that the way we define the input rank values for the contracted problem, the value we compute is actually the final value we want for the original problem. Because basically, by adding the appropriate rank values. Here we are maintaining the invariants that we already used for the prefix doubling algorithm, that following successor pointers and adding up R values gives you the sum that you want. So how does that, so we have solved now the problem for a subset of the elements. And the other nice thing about choosing independent sets is that now it's very easy to reconstruct the ranks of the removed elements, because the removed elements, they just look at their successor, and by construction, their successor is not in the independent set. So for it, I know the final rank value. So I simply, to reconstruct the overall result, for example, here for the 5, I just say, okay, what is the rank value of my successor? That is a 6. And I myself have a rank value of 1, so 6 plus 1 is 7. So in constant time, I can now reconstruct the rank values for all the other values. And so let's already think why this is efficient. The point here is that I get an efficient algorithm if the size of the independent set is at least a constant fraction. Because what I'm doing is I have a recursion that removes the constant fractions of elements in each iteration. Yeah, but maybe let's argue the efficiency more formally later. So the difference, but maybe let's very qualitatively argue. The difference to the pointer doubling algorithm is that I have a similar recursion depth here, or number of iterations if you want. But in each iteration, I'm removing a constant fraction of the data. And that's why I'm overall doing less work. And that will turn out to be efficient overall, actually. But let's now see how this is realized in the pseudocode. So we have this procedure, independent set removal algorithm for list ranking. We have a list of size n, and we have successor, predecessor, and input rank arrays. We actually need a base case, and what we do is if the number of processors is larger than the or equal than the number of elements, we simply use the doubling algorithm. Now we find an independent set. What does it mean? The formal specification is the set I has to fulfill the property that each index I in this set has successor of I is not in the set and predecessor of I is not in the set. And also for actually contracting the input, I'm computing a mapping F of the surviving elements to the compact range 1 to number of surviving elements. So as an exercise, maybe think about how this bijective mapping can be computed. As a hint, we have seen very similar problems before. Okay. So now we have to build this contracted instance so that for each surviving index I in parallel, we do the following. The successor value is jumping two steps ahead if the successor is in the independent set. Otherwise, it's just jumping one step ahead. But I'm mapping it to this contracted array. That's why I'm applying this function f. Yes? The predecessor array works analogously. If the predecessor is in the independent set, I jump to the predecessor of the predecessor. Otherwise, I just jump to the predecessor, and I'm applying this mapping function to map it to the right position in the contracted input. And the rank value, finally, if the successor is in the independent set, I add up my rank value with the rank value of the successor. Otherwise, I just keep the old rank value. Now I can call the procedure recursively on an input of size n minus size of I using these contracted arrays S prime, P prime, and R prime. Finally, I have to copy the result value into the array from R prime to R, and again I can use this F function to do this mapping. And for the elements in the independent set, I set the rank value to the local rank value plus the rank value in the contracted problem. And again, I need this function to map it in the right way. Okay, so what's lacking from this algorithm is how to find independent sets. And I will present here a very simple randomized algorithm that finds an independent set of average size n over 4. So it's very simple. We throw a coin for each cell, so number 0 or 1. And we put I into the independent set if both the cell throws a 1 and the successor of the cell throws a 0. Note that this also implies that the previous element will not go into the independent set because if the predecessor throws a 1, it will notice that its successor, namely I, also threw a 1 and will not go into the independent set. And the expected size is n over 4. Maybe as a little exercise, think about why this is the case. And now there's some technicality stuff here. We could simply work with this expected size of n over 4 for the subsequent analysis, but to make that more formally watertight, I will look at a different variant of this algorithm, namely, so this is kind of a Monte Carlo algorithm. It has a certain probability to achieve the size, and actually the expectation alone doesn't tell us what this probability is. So I will go a different path and say I convert this Monte Carlo algorithm into a Las Vegas algorithm. So Monte Carlo algorithm is an algorithm that may fail with a certain probability, whereas the Las Vegas algorithm always has a guaranteed result, but the running time might be a random variable. So what we simply do is we repeat this process of coin throwing and identifying an independent set until the size of the independent set is at least n over 5. And maybe if you want, you can also think about why we use this thing and not n over 4. The reason is related to Markov's inequality. Maybe you have a look what that is. And we can discuss that in the inverted classroom session. So basically the expected time for doing this once is n over p. There's a different cost for running the Las Vegas algorithm, but maybe we can talk about this also during the inverted classroom session. But what's important for us now is that we can efficiently find an independent set of linear size. And the constant factors are not so important, at least from a theoretical point of view. Now,
the bijective mapping. Oh, I told you should think about it yourself. Maybe you did. That's nice. But here I solve the riddle. We simply do a prefix sum computation, similar to what we did in Quicksort, actually. And the prefix sum is computed over this indicator value whether j is not in the independent set, right? So we set a 1 if the element is not in the independent set. And then by computing a prefix sum, we enumerate the elements that are not in the independent set. And we can use that as an index into the contracted subproblem.
So let's analyze this algorithm. The running time can be described, or at least the expected running time, by recurrence of the form n over p plus log p plus the time for the recursive call. And if we use this Las Vegas algorithm, we get time 4/5 times n at most. In expectation. And yeah, maybe in the inverted classroom section, we can also talk more about why this n over p plus log p is there. Maybe think about this already. We have to assign complexities to the individual pieces of this pseudocode, right? Let's talk about this later then. Yes, the number of recursion levels is log n over p. Maybe let's also talk about this. Why is this? Because this is our all exam question that I typically ask. So how do you analyze this and not only reproduce something that I give in the lecture, but also explain what's behind this? Yes, and if I'm summing this up, then I get a geometric sum here. Namely, for the initial recursion level, we have some constant times n over p. Let's ignore this term for now. And then in the recursive call, it's the same constant times 4/5 times n over p. And then it's the same constant times 4/5 times 4/5 times n over p, and so on. So it's we can take out the n over p out of this sum and get a geometric sum, 1 plus 4/5 plus 4/5 squared plus 4/5 to the cubed, and so on, right? And even summing it to infinity gives us still a num. Basically, the sum is bounded. So the sum over 1 plus 4/5 plus 4/5 squared and so on is, I think, something like 1/1 minus 4/5. So it's actually 5. So it's this constant times 5 times n over p, which is still order n over p. And then I have this term. Well, here I simply multiply this term with the number of recursion levels, which is log n over p. So I get order n over p plus log n over p times log p.
Okay, so we have an expression here that's somewhat complicated. We have a product of two logarithms with different arguments. And so I think it makes sense to look at it a little bit more closely in order to understand what it means. I mean, we would have liked to have something like n over p plus log p. That was what we got, for example, for reduction using Brand's principle or prefix sums. So on the first glance, it now looks it's a log factor worse. But it's not quite that. So maybe we can ask this scalability question again. So how big should the input be in order to get linear work overall? Or on this slide, I've turned that around. How many processors can you use efficiently? So for example, for reduction, it was n over log n, and for prefix sums. Now it turns out we just need to reduce the number of processors by another factor log log n. So it's actually quite close. So why is that? Because if n is something like
times a polylogarithmic factor, then you can write here p polylogarithmic factor, and then the p cancels out and you get a double logarithm, right? And that's actually a very small overhead. Whereas when n is much larger than n, than p, say p squared or so, then this term doesn't matter anyway, because then this term dominates. So this overhead term is only important for the case where n and p differ only by a polylogarithmic factor. And in that case, actually, this thing gets a double logarithmic factor, which is quite harmless. So what else is known about list ranking? So first, on the theoretical side, there are randomized algorithms that even avoid this additional logarithmic or double logarithmic term. So they have just running time order log n on when you have one processor per element. And you can even do that in a deterministic way, but then the algorithms get really complicated. There are many applications within theoretical constructions for PRAM, where you use list ranking as a subroutine. There were actually a small number of concrete implementations actually already relatively early by my former colleague, Jupp Siebein, on a distributed memory machine. With 100 processors, he got a speed up of 30. So this is surprisingly good, given that this was, I described it as a rather theoretical thing for shared memory machines, but with a very different algorithm, by the way. List ranking can be generalized for segmented lists. So what I mean with this is you have a bunch of list items and they form several lists, and also for trees. Generalization for general graphs is not quite that simple, but conceptually, similar things happen by when you contract edges or nodes. And we will see an example of edge contraction actually in the chapter on graph algorithms. And another reason why I gave this concrete example is that it's a nice example for a multi-level algorithm. So in contrast to a linear recursion, it's you could view it as a linear recursion, but the difference is that in many linear recursion algorithms like reduction, you basically process a problem to get really smaller. You only have to look at a part of the problem somehow. Whereas in a multi-level algorithm, you kind of compress your input to represent the overall thing. That may be a differentiation of terms, but somehow the multi-level thing is, in a sense, a little bit more interesting. There are also a few practical things for modern implementations. Namely, I think the main thing that you can improve here is that you try to get closer to Brand's principle by doing something more resembling the sequential algorithm where you walk along the list, which you can do reasonably efficiently. And what you do here is that you remove not just an independent set, but almost everything, and then solve the problem by walking. So concretely, what you can do is you can sample as random places in the list and cut the list into sublists there. And then you run the sequential algorithm on each sublist. I mean, there will be some load balancing things because the sublength lists don't have the same length for all of them. But that's something one can solve, and you will see such techniques actually in the next chapter. And then if you have solved the sublift, you run a recursive problem, a multi-level thing if you want, a compressed thing on a instance of size S. So you can compress in a single step that takes a little bit, that takes linear work. You can compress a list of size N to a list of size S, and that might be a big factor, not just 4 over 5, but maybe 100, 1 over 100, right? And there's an implementation paper on it that actually achieves speed up like 10 on an 8-core CPU. It's interesting why they get superlinear speed up, maybe because of cache effects. So that brings us to the end of the short chapter on list ranking.